Watson back after missing the LSU game. Third and four, 10th play of the draw. Out of the spread, stunts and a blitz. And a little crossing pattern inside. A little underneath to Fred Gibson in front of Charlie Pepper.
Yeah. It's a nice quick throw, quick read by David Greene. They put the back in motion, and that kind of cleared out that middle of the defense. It also tells David Greene it's man-to-man coverage, and he's got a nice throwing lane to Gibson on the slant.
Well, they get Gibson back. 6'4", 196-pounder, a junior from White Cross. He's got 8 games in his career in which he's caught in excess of 100 yards in passes. They try to sweep with Milton. Nice cutback. Tony Milton on first down. Stopped at the 13. The season is now officially underway.
Right. The fly and the VCS ointment.
That's turn. First time we've heard the fly this year. Here's Green. Pressure from the backside. It's incomplete. It'll be third down.
Antoine Odom, who they were wondering whether he was even going to be able to play today because he had an ankle and a knee kind of banged up the week before. He's coming from the backside of David Greene, and he's their best pass rusher. And he gets a little bit of a hand on the football and also on the arm of David Greene.
Well, a third down coming, and I'm sure Billy Bennett pacing on the sideline is Mike Shula. Bennett missed 3 field goals last week. 2 weeks ago in the loss at LSU, and said yesterday the first one today would be very important. Here's Damian Garrett. It's a moot point for the moment.
Really nice play by Jawan Garth, again that young linebacker, because that play looked like it was set up very well, and he came from a long way away to make a play and save a first down, if not a touchdown.
And Billy Bennett trotting on the field.
Daniel Inman slow getting up, the starting tackle for Georgia, seems to be okay.
Billy Bennett said that was the first time in his career he'd ever missed 3 in a game. He thought it was the first time in practice he'd ever missed 3.
He looked good before the game warming up. I mean, I think he'll be fine. He has normally been so solid.
Welcome back, Billy Bennett. Yes. Of course, it's kind of nice to have a 26-yarder for you.
Absolutely. But for Billy Bennett, you'll take anything right now, because the psyche of a kicker can be very fragile. Even one who's had so much success in the past is Billy Bennett. And nobody happier in this stadium for making that kick right now than Billy Bennett.
We've got a 3-3 tie. The SEC on CBS, Alabama and Georgia. And Billy Bennett, who had that really rough afternoon a week ago.
And I'm sure Mark Richt is thrilled that Billy Bennett made his first field goal, but again, the red zone problems as far as getting it in the end zone. Now 18 trips inside the opponent's 20-yard line and still only 7 touchdowns.
Bennett will kick off, a chore that he has taken on this year. Ray Hudson, Ramsey Robinson are the deep men for Alabama. Very short kick taken at the 22-yard line and a fair catch.
Yeah, smart play.
Clint Johnston, the tight end.
Smart play by Clint Johnston. He's a backup tight end. He's not going to outrun anybody, and he made sure he made the catch.
Well, Alabama offense. Wesley Britt and Justin Smiley. Smiley, a preseason All-American. J.B. Klausner, Dennis Alexander, and Evan Mathis. Shawn Williams, a fine running back. Freshman Tim Castillo, you saw the wide receivers as well. High formation, here's Ray Hudson, who is in the lineup now, number 27, as they rest Shawn Williams. And defensively for the Georgia Bulldogs. Gathers, Golston, Ken Beal, and David Pollock, the All-American. Ray Gant, who was a starter, serving a 1-game suspension. Danny Verdun, a true freshman, gets the start at one linebacker. Derek White at the other. That's because of injuries. Thornton Davis, Sean Jones, and DeCorey Bryant in the secondary. Hudson starts left, comes back right. and runs into Derek White, number 53. Defensive coordinator Brian Van Gorder had a very serious demeanor when we talked to him yesterday. He said, I just got through watching Thursday's practice film. We put a frown on your face.
Now, well, he's a perfectionist, but he also has some legitimate concerns with those two new young outside linebackers because of all the shifting in motion that Alabama had shown. But with a new quarterback for Alabama, they're not doing as much as that with Spencer Pennington as they might have done with Brody Croy.
Derek White is starting for Tony Taylor, who's hurt. Blitz, Thomas Davis, pass tipped away, Bruce Thornton.
Yeah, great play by Thornton. Timed it, didn't make previous contact. And Thomas Davis, the free safety, was there for the big hit just in case Thornton didn't get a hand on the football. Davis rushing off the edge. I mean, this is a unique guy. He's a free safety, but he rushes the passer as a defensive end on third down.
And we've got an injured player now for Georgia, Ken Veal, number 96.
Boy, he has just had a rough year. I mean, he's had an ankle injury. He has not played much this season. He just hasn't been able to get healthy. You know, ankles are tough for anybody, but when you weigh over 300 pounds, I mean, it's really tough. And take a look. He's right here in the middle, number 96, Kenny Veal. He's going to get double teamed, and one of his own guys, Pollock, who's coming on an inside rush, crashed into the back of his leg. And
Ken Veal will be assisted to the sideline. Check out CBS Sportsline scoreboard for the best live play-by-play from every top 25 college football game. Just click on NCAA at CBSSportsline.com.
This is an area where I think Alabama has to really improve from last week, actually the last couple weeks, is their punting by Bo Freeland and their punt coverage. Right now they are last in the SEC in net punting, and a couple short punts in the fourth quarter really hurt them last week against Arkansas.
Those punts went 20 and 26 yards. Here's Bo Freeland, and this one not terribly good either. And it is taken and dropped at the 38-yard line. That's a 35-yard punt. There is nothing on the return. But 6 punts last week for Freeland, 33.8 yards. Okay.
See, I watched him on the practice field, and he's got a great leg. I mean, he booms it. But in the game, he hasn't kicked the same way. He's got to change that.
First quarter, we're tied at 3.
Dennis Rowland, now a sophomore tackle, is in for Georgia in place of Daniel Inman. So a backup in. The good news for Alabama, Ahmad Childress is in for Tatum, and he was the starter.
Here's a play fake. Green comes out to his left, being chased, lobs it out. Caught, Jeremy Thomas. Well, you have seen his first and his second catches of the season on the field goal drive. A 42-yard catch, and this one's good for 13.
And this is just a case of David Greene not losing, you know, not giving up on the play and not losing his poise. Because for a minute, it wasn't there what he wanted to throw. Good pressure by Childress. And right now, David Greene's thinking, just, you know, get what I can and get out of bounds. And he just happened to glance upfield and see Jeremy Thomas and hit him with the nice, easy flick.
Two catches for Thomas, a first down. Here's play fake. Greene goes deep. The adjustment trying to be made, and there is no flag. Anthony Madison was the defender on Mario Raley, number 80.
Well, a little miscommunication, but also some pressure from Naughton McKay Losher. He comes in and gets the hit on David Greene from the backside, but down the field, Mario Raley, who has been out with an injury, and he's just back for the first game against Anthony Madison, and that's a good no call because the ball was uncatchable anyway.
And worth another mention that Reggie Brown, who has 7 catches in each of the last 3 games, unable to go today for Georgia because of a pulled hamstring. Here's Green across the middle, diving back, made it to 35. Tight end, Ben Watson.
Yeah, see, he just adds a different dimension because when you have a tight end who can run, who can get down the middle of the field, then it opens up in the defense. You play action, that holds the linebackers, and then you get the strong safety trail on them, and they've missed Ben Watson. They've missed another weapon attacking the middle of the defense.
Brian McClendon in as a wide out. He's wide to the right. Now he starts in motion. Hand off to Lumpkin, who heads right. And picks up one. All right, thank you, Tim. 3-3 here with 4:05 to go in the first quarter of play. Spread formation now. Green behind J.D. Klausner. Downs left. Wow. Tipped. Ah, nice play.
And a holding penalty is going to go against Georgia, but David Greene did not see Juwan Garth coming in there. Antoine Odom again with good pressure on David Greene, and I think that's where the penalty was going to be drawn.
Face mask.
Take a look. Someone grabbed a face mask. Oh, here it is right here. Yeah. Antoine Odom. Max Gene Gillis working on it.
Personal foul. Face mask against the offense. The penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot. Replay second down.
That's even worse than holding. You know, instead of a 10-yard penalty for holding, you get a 15-yarder for a personal foul. And Antoine Odom looks very explosive. I didn't expect to see him look this good because he had a knee and an ankle banged up late in the game against Arkansas last week, but he looks good coming off the football.
Odom wearing number 98. 6'5", 273-pounder. Second and 24 in a 3-3 ball game. Larry Moments, first quarter. Green. Well, I'm smiling now because David Greene is wearing a brace because of the hyperextended knee, and he told us yesterday, I guess it will take away my spin move.
Good coverage downfield, and really a good job also by Juwan Garth, who's playing an outstanding first quarter here for Alabama because he came on a delay blitz. Watch David Greene. He never has been a great runner. He's got that big offensive lineman. He got away from Garth on the spin move. You got to give it up. He got away from one. Just didn't get away from two.
Third and 26. Three down for Alabama. See if they bring five. Nope, they bring three. Green got a man open. It's Watson again. What a presence he's been here in the first quarter. That is short of first down.
Well, short of the first down because he had to lay out. Had he been able to catch it on the move, he would have gotten the first down. Four vertical. They just run down the seam of a three-deep zone defense. And again, when you have a tight end who's got the speed to run this kind of route, he just adds something different to your offense.
And that's going to bring on Billy Bennett for his second field goal attempt. This one from 44 yards away. Lee Jackson is the holder. Brian Jordan is the center. Boy, does that have plenty of distance. Whoa!
He's back.
Bennett will kick off. Ramsey Robinson, Ray Hudson are the two deep men. This one returnable. Taken by Hudson inside the five. Oh, good deal for Alabama. They were 98th in the country in kickoff returns coming in, but that one is out to the 35-yard line. It's a 32-yard return.
Yeah, this opened up really nicely. It set up. It was a kick that went to the left hash, and it was a right return, and it was very well executed by Alabama. See, no red shirts anywhere near Hudson until he got up around the 30-yard line. So good execution by the Alabama special team.
And Spencer Pennington on and replacing Brody Coyle. As Alabama has run only five plays so far in the first quarter. Play fake. Pennington being chased. There's Sean Jones. Got him. He flips it out acrobatically. It's an incomplete pass, but how about the pass rush of Sean Jones?
Well, you're not going to outrun many of the defenders on this Georgia defense. I mean, that's the one trademark of this defense is their speed. Here's Sean Jones right here. Watch him come in, and then he just kind of sits and spies on the quarterback. And as soon as he thinks he has a seam, he makes the break for Pennington. Sean Jones has just had an outstanding season so far as the starting safety for Georgia, and he was spying on the quarterback all the way.
Second and 10. Well played, Sean Williams. And the 5'8", 190-pounder gets three out to the 38-yard line. The tackle made by Danny Verdun-Huilon, true freshman from Thompson, Georgia.
We talked about it. We showed the graphic now. That's only seven offensive plays now for Alabama here in the first quarter. In the last 2 weeks, that's been their problem. They've had some big plays, but they haven't been able to possess the football. The last two games, they've averaged only 64 snaps a game on offense. That's not enough. I mean, you've got to possess the ball more. You've got to convert third downs and move the chains.
Third and eight here. Here comes the blitz. And there's Thomas Davis. Oh, my. Got him with a one-arm tackle.
See, this guy is a nightmare for an offensive lineman. This is Atlas Harrien, who's going to be the outside tackle. Thomas Davis is a speed guy. And when there was a little hesitation by Harry, and that's all Davis needed to turn the corner quickly on him and then go right to the quarterback. This is a talented football player, a guy who can play safety, he could play linebacker, and he can rush the passer, as we saw right there.
And there is sadly another Georgia player down. This is Quentin Moses, the backup defensive end. That's David Pollock. Helps him to his feet. Moses. Redshirt freshman from here in Athens, who also, like Fred Gibson, played for the basketball team last year. And here is Bo Freeland on to punt again. Damian Gary awaits it. This has been a less than successful part of Alabama's game, but this is a good one.
There it is.
Yep. Nail that. Gary at the 15. And the all-time leader in punt returns for Georgia counterpunches with his 92nd career return. That's a 55-yard punt and 12 on the return for Damian Garrett. My wife and I watched that.
Did you?
It was very good.
Yes.
Nancy and Joe.
Good.
A little free promo.
Mm-hmm.
First down and 10.
If you get any swag from that show, I might send you something. Who knows?
No, I'm not on the swag list. First and 10. There's the handoff to Tyson Browning, number 31. Well, you know, we get the pleasure of doing Georgia, Florida, Tim, and that's always fun for us. But that Texas, Oklahoma, that's a special one, too. And here is Michael Johnson with the catch. Michael Johnson, who normally wears number 23, is wearing number 4 today. Michael Johnson is wearing this number in honor of senior Kentrell Curry, who last week made a decision to undergo surgery and saw his career as a fine defensive back come to an end. So Johnson asked if he could wear number 4 just for this afternoon, normally number 25.
That's a shame, too, because Kentrell Curry, we had a great season last year. I mean, the NFL scouts were extremely high on him this year, and he just couldn't get it going.
Handoff. Oh, boy. There's Tyson Browning. And Ahmad Childress, number 95, got up around the chin.
Yeah, and Ahmad Childress is playing well. See, he didn't play last week because of a shoulder injury. And so they started Kyle Tatum, but Ahmad Childress is off to a good start in the first quarter here.
And it has been a good first quarter. That's the end of the score, 6-3. We'll return to Sanford Stadium after this message and this word from your local station. We'll be proud to claim Sean Jones, Thomas Davis. They play for Georgia. Georgia has a 6-3 lead. And as we open the second quarter, they face a second and 11 with David Greene at quarterback. Ball at the 39. And off Tyson Browning comes right. He's got speed. Spills. He crosses the 50. And he gets to the 49-yard line. We get underway from Sanford Stadium in Athens. Vernon Todd and Jill down on the sideline. With the exception of that David Greene interception in the second play, Georgia's had things go their way.
Well, they've been dominant. I mean, you know, they have outgained them. They've had more plays. I mean, they've dominated the action. And they've had a chance to keep the Alabama defense on the field for most of that first quarter. Alabama, no first downs in that first quarter. So Georgia really controlling things, just no touchdowns to show for it.
And a first down and 10 after the Browning run. Here's Greene with a play fake. Little pressure. Caught. Damian Gary. And he's got another first down as he gets to the 38-yard line. That is a gain of 12.
Roman Harper went for the deflection or the interception, the strong safety, and just couldn't get a hand on the football. Damian Gary is the slot receiver. Here he is working on the little out route, and Roman Harper, number 41, is going to go for the football and just doesn't get a hand on it. It's a nice throw by David Greene to the outside arm of his receiver, and Damian Gary made the nice play.
And a flag thrown on the near side at the line of scrimmage.
Well, David Greene tried to call timeout, but it's going to be an illegal substitution penalty on Georgia. Michael Johnson was late getting off the field.
Illegal substitution against the offense. The penalty is 5 yards from the previous spot. Still first down.
Michael Johnson.
A little confusion on personnel groupings, and you can see as they are looking back and looking, and they're trying to call timeout, and right there is Michael Johnson, who had tried to get off the field, but they broke the huddle with 12 guys, and that's why they got the penalty.
So first and 15, but eight first downs now, Todd, for Georgia, and none for Alabama.
And see, this is an Alabama defense that was on the field a lot last week, a double overtime loss to a physical football team in Arkansas.
Here comes Lumpkin. There goes Lumpkin.
Wow.
Whoa, what a shoulder. David Scott felt the brunt of that, number 23.
And Jeremy Thomas, the fullback, with a great clear-out block on Jawan Garth. But watch Lumpkin lower the shoulder and get better leverage on a smaller guy.
Woo!
David Scott, only 181 pounds, and he felt all of that one.
Lumpkin is a true freshman, one of the widely sought running backs in Georgia high school. He's from Lithonia. Here's Green with play action, steps up, under pressure, lets it go. And let's get an injury report. Once again, here's Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, I'm not getting a lot of official information from the Georgia staff, but what I can tell you is Daniel Emmon is out of the locker room. They've taped up his ankle. They've added an additional brace. They're going to try to get him back on the field, but not such good news on the defensive side. Ken Veal has ice on his ankle, and he's on crutches. Doesn't look like he'll be returning.
No, sure doesn't. Thank you, Jill.
Crutches are never a good sign, I mean, as far as trying to get back in the game.
That's Will Thompson, number 58. Starting defensive end, projected as a starter, and he's out with a dislocated ankle. That happened before the season began. Here's Green, inside pattern for Brian McClendon. Incomplete pass.
Big stop right there for Alabama. Big stop on third down. One of the other things we need to find out, we're seeing David Scott in the lineup a lot for Alabama, who is not the starting corner. Anthony Madison has not been in there, and David Scott, who's a senior but has not played a lot, is in for Alabama.
Wow. And they're going to let Billy Bennett try one from 52 yards away. His career long is 55, but how satisfying would this be for Bennett, and he might have it. He has got it. Quick screen, this is who you're talking about.
That's right. Man, that was no doubt.
And what a credit to the coaching staff to say, go do it. Billy Bennett, three field goals, the latest of which measured 52 yards. And it is 9-3 after that 37-yard drive, 9 plays. Bennett will kick off.
And I said it the last time we were having a Georgia kickoff, and I'll say it again, a critical offensive possession for Alabama. 3 possessions, 3 three-and-outs. I mean, they've got to keep the football for a little bit here.
Bennett, Ramsey Robinson at the 3-yard line. Contact made as he nears the 25-yard line. Well, those of you around the country who listen with regularity understand that there's a highlight in each half, and it's time now for the
Aflac
trivia question of the week. I never know from which direction you're going to come. Name the first quarterback in NCAA history to start 4 consecutive bowl games. The first. I think we might get a few folks with this one. This is not really obvious. Has a connection to this game, obviously. Pennington dropped. Little behind David Cabin.
Well, you got a tight end, David Cabin, who's got a bad hand. And that was a tough catch, even if he had two good hands. But one of those hands is all bandaged up, that right thumb. And he's throwing right to that right thumb, and the ball just bounces right off of that soft cast. But Spencer Pennington desperately needs to complete a couple of those passes because they've got to get some momentum offensively for nothing else, just to let their defense rest.
Second and 10. David Pollock this time lined up to the left side at defensive end. There's Pennington back. Left side incomplete. Intended for Ray Hudson. Tim, I knew you'd find one circling around.
TCU's a little bigger than the fly. They might be like a dragonfly. Northern Illinois might be like a mosquito, but they're a good football team. They're in the ointment too.
Third and 10. Handoff. Hudson coming left. Pursued by Odell Thurman and by Tim Jennings, numbers 33 and 23.
And again, four offensive possessions, four three and outs. And you give the ball right back to David Greene and the Georgia offense.
And they go against the defense, which, as you said, was on the field so long a time last week.
And when you play a team like Arkansas, they beat you up physically, too, because when they run so much, that takes more out of you than a passing offense. So a very draining physical game last week.
Uh-oh. The block is on, and they've got it. That's a free ball. Thomas Davis has it, and that is a Georgia touchdown. It's the first block punt of the year. It's the second block kick of the year.
Well, it was Jarrett Berry right there, number 85, who got the block, but they tricked him because they brought Ja'Cory Bryant in off of the gunner, and that drew the block, and it opened things up for Jarrett Berry. Now, Ja'Cory Bryant's going to come in right here, and that draws the block, and that leaves nobody to block Jarrett Berry. An excellent call by the special teams of Georgia.
Bennett's extra point is up and good. This is a Georgia team that last year, in going 13-1, had nine blocked kicks, punts and field goals and extra points. You just saw their second of this season. Jarrett Berry with the block. That is the second time that Freeland of Alabama has been blocked this year.
It's fun to watch them work on punt blocks in practice. They use volleyballs to practice so that they don't get hurt or break a finger with a football, but they use volleyballs out there for their punt block team, and they got one today.
Bennett will kick off. Robinson and Hudson, this one's very short and heading to the left. It'll go out of bounds. So a rare mistake today for Billy Bennett.
Let's go back to the block punt. I want you to look at three different guys, okay? Right here, Ja'Cory Bryant. Here's Berry. And watch Juwan Garth right here, because what happens is, as he comes in, Juwan Garth blocks here, and that leaves Berry open to go right to the kicker. You always want to block the most dangerous defensive guy. That would be guy who has the shortest path to the kicker. Juwan Garth made a mistake in blocking Ja'Cory Bryant and not Jarrett Berry. And Berry was there for the easy block, but excellent design by Georgia. And sometimes, you know, when you have an off week, you also have extra time to prepare something special like that in special teams. And they really were ready for that one.
And Alabama still looking for its first down. We've had a field goal followed by three punts.
And they got to find a way to get 21 in the game. He's only got two carries for 3 yards. If they can't run it with him, throw it to him. But 21's got to touch the football.
And he touches it now on the draw play and picks up a couple over right guard. Derek White, who got the start, number 53, starting today in place of Tony Taylor, who's out with an ankle. We were talking with David Pollock yesterday, the outstanding defensive end, about the absence of Tony Taylor and what it means to them in communication, that Taylor's a great communicator.
Yeah, he's one of the real communicators in making sure they adjust to strength and formation. But again, with the young quarterback, Spencer Pennington, Alabama is not doing what they've done previous to this game.
Here's a blitz. And Charles Williams Another difficult yard. Sean Jones makes the tackle. 11:50 to go in the second quarter of play. Three field goals by Billy Bennett, followed by a blocked punt, recovered by Thomas Davis, and then he leaped into the end zone to make it 16-3. Third and seven. And Alabama trying to avoid another three and out.
And Alabama has not had a third down play under 6 yards in this ball game so far. And right now, another one at third and seven.
Spencer Pennington getting his first start today in place of the injured Brody Croyle will scramble. And that's going to be close.
Wow, he lost the football and his helmet. Man. These safeties will hit you now. They'll hit you. Derek White got the hit there, but watch Pennington. He's going to lose his helmet first. Boom, and then the ball comes out second.
Six passing yards, minus two rushing. Young man from Fayette, Alabama, who showed great promise as a baseball player in high school. As a junior, he batted .470 for the season. Also led his American Legion team in baseball. Fourth down.
I think you almost have to go for it.
I do too.
If you're Mike Shula. I mean, you've got to keep your offense on the field. You've got a veteran, senior-led offensive line. You got to count on those guys to get a half a yard here on fourth down.
Well, for the season, Alabama hit its first six fourth down plays in succession. They were stopped in their last one, but they are 7 of 8 for the season now. Fourth and inches. Quarterback sneak? I don't know. Oh, I do not know. They stayed up high.
Yeah, they didn't get much push underneath. And I don't think he got it. Nope, they're not even going to bring the chains out.
Look at David Parr. He's a joy to watch. He's not had a fun season so far this year, but joy there.
See, this is not Spencer Pennington's fault. This is the center and the two guards did not get low enough, and they didn't get any push up front. And David Pollock thrilled with the way those inside defensive tackles made that play on fourth down.
Meanwhile, 38-year-old head coach Mike Shula on the sidelines. Stoic reaction. And DJ Shockley is on a quarterback now. First time we've seen him in the first half in the last couple of games. And he's going to take off. This is the dimension he brings that David Greene doesn't have.
You know what? This Alabama team, they're out of gas. The defense is out of gas. I mean, they're out there trying. But when your offense cannot keep the football and cannot make a first down, you just... And coming off of the game that they came off of last week, they don't have enough depth to rotate a bunch of guys in there, and they are barely hanging on right now.
And here is DJ Shockley. Looked a little, well, he looked very shaky in his appearance in the second half at LSU 2 weeks ago, and had minimal playing time here at home against South Carolina, but he'll take it on the quarterback draw. And that was a designed play. He's inside the 30. Well, 2 years ago, or last year rather, Shockley was injured and missed 4 games, but the plan all along for Mark Richt was to share playing time with Greene, the starter. Kind of gone by the wayside this season.
It has, and part of that is because David Greene, you know, they lost 1 game last year and won the SEC championship, and David Greene was the offensive player of the year. And this year he's been playing outstanding football, and so Mark Richt is just not so set on having to play DJ Shockley at a certain time every game. He's doing it more by feel.
There's a quick poke back to Damon Gary. Browning got a good block in the corner.
Browning got a good block, but he's the one that ended up on his backside. But he got in the way.
Well, okay.
He got in the way.
Well said.
And that's what he needed. Watch this. Number 31 is going to end up on his bottom right there. But he got enough of a distraction on Charlie Pepper that Damian Gary was able to turn it into a good play.
Well, from a certain perspective, it looked like a good block.
I mean, that's a reverse pancake. But it worked.
Oh, laud his effort. Here's Browning up the middle to the 10-yard line. Now you just get a sense that Alabama is dangerously close to letting this one just fly away. Ball at the 10.
You know, and it's not a lack of discipline. It's not a lack of effort. It's just a lack of energy. Again, they played a physical Arkansas team last week. They went to double overtime. They gave up almost 300 yards rushing to a physical team, and they can't get off the field today.
Hand off Browning, skips behind the line and gets back to the 10. 16-3. David Greene was intercepted on his first pass of the day. That set up a field goal for Alabama. And yet again, we've got Georgia inside the red zone.
One David field goal in there today. And David Greene gets to watch DJ Shockley this time.
Brett Gibson and Damian Gary are wide left. Michael Johnson wide right.
Wouldn't be surprised to see another quarterback draw here.
That's Jamario Smith, number 37. Play fake. Wide open. That is Jamario Smith with a touchdown.
That is the Verron Hayes play.
Yes, it is.
Worked on it on Thursday. It's an automatic check if they saw the defense they wanted. And they slipped the fullback right through the middle. And DJ Shockley executed it perfectly.
The Verron Hayes play refers to a Tennessee win 2 years ago.
See, DJ Shockley read it. Now he gets him in the eye. Now watch the fullback slip right here, and nobody picks him up. The linebackers get fooled. Nobody picks up the fullback. Easy touchdown.
In that game 2 years ago, it was David Greene to Verron Haynes. And Georgia won it on the road 26-24. They're dominating this one. Sophomore from Forsyth, Georgia. Touchdown catch.
Now that was good for so many reasons for Georgia. Number one, they get a touchdown in the red zone. Number two, it's DJ Shockley, who, you know, hasn't played as well this year or as much as he had last year. And he makes the check. He reads the defense, checks to the right play, and they get the big lead now in the ball game.
23-3 with under 8 to go first half. This has just been an overwhelming domination by Georgia. On the fly, Robinson to the 31-yard line, picked up. Fumble. Here's Davis again.
Well, you see that C on his jersey? He's the special teams captain today. You want to have really good special teams, you put your best players on special teams. Thomas Davis is running down on kickoff coverage. Jamario Minter is the guy that's going to cause the fumble, and Thomas Davis is there to collect it. There's the strip by Minter, number two, and Thomas Davis in position to get the football.
Well, Thomas Davis is playing at an all-SEC caliber at defensive back, and he's just a wonderfully gifted athlete. In high school, Shelman, Georgia, he played running back, defensive back, wide receiver, punter, a little bit of everything. And there's Jamario Smith going down as David Greene comes on, and Charles Jones.
Well, they are banging the walls next to us in the Georgia box because Ben Watson, the tight end, was wide open. And David Greene couldn't get him the football. A little bootleg. Watch Ben Watson get to the end zone right here. And he opts for going for the fullback. But watch Ben Watson clear in the back of the end zone. He's wide open. David Greene just can't get him the football. And they were stomping and pounding next door.
Second down. Second and 10, 23-3. Handoff, right side, Greg Lumpkin diving, touchdown. Nope, one official says in, the other says he's out of bounds. Line judge says out of bounds at the 3-yard line.
Well, this running back by committee deal is working out pretty good for Georgia, trying to replace Musa Smith because they're all a little bit different. Lumpkin is a big physical guy. Tyson Browning, more the scat back. There's the foot out. Good call by the officials. He did get the ball over the pylon, but not before the foot was out of bounds.
Thus, it becomes a first and goal.
Yeah, give him a chance to score.
That is the 12th. First down, and here's Lumpkin testing the middle down at the 1 yard line.
I would say that Georgia was anxious to play a football game after 2 weeks of stewing over their loss to LSU in a game that they felt they should have won. Now they gained over 400 yards of offense. Their defense played well except for a couple lapses in that game. And they came away really upset they didn't win that game, and they have been waiting to play a game for 2 weeks.
Power formation with Lumpkin, the running back, gets a great block and strolls in untouched. Jamario Smith went down low on Charles Jones and cleaned his clock.
Can't run out of the I formation if you don't have a good blocking fullback. And there's the block by Jamario Smith. He got right into the legs, as you said, of Charles Jones, and an easy touchdown for Lumpkin.
Bennett for the extra point. He's now hit 100 in a row. That's the second longest active streak in the NCAA. He follows Dusty Mangum of Texas, who's at 110. I think going the way of the Georgia Bulldogs, they're up 30-3 with 6:54 still to go, second quarter. And that after falling behind 3-0 in what I'm sure for Alabama seems like hours ago. Billy Bennett will kick off. Again, he goes deep left side. And this one into the end zone will be taken out by Ramsey Robinson. Fumbled on his last attempt. And there's Thomas Davis, the captain of the special teams, who spills him at the 30. And it is time now to answer the
Affleck
trivia question of the day. Who was the... Oh, we'll give the duck a stroll here. The first quarterback in NCAA history to start 4 consecutive bowl games. And the answer is John Rauch of Georgia. Oil Bowl, Sugar Bowl, Gator Bowl, Orange Bowl. And he was honored in pregame ceremonies, John Rauch. And an inductee into the 2003 Hall of Fame. Brody Croyle is on at quarterback now, first time. Separated left shoulder, pass incomplete. Intended for Clint Johnson.
Flag down on the play as well, and it is kind of desperate times right now for Alabama and Mike Shula. No first downs, only 19 yards of offense. And the thing about Brody's injury is you don't really know whether he can hurt it worse or not. It's kind of iffy. I mean, he's got a separated left shoulder, but you know what? He actually injured his shoulder first against Oklahoma. He's been playing with a bad left shoulder since the first game. And so, I mean, he's obviously a tough kid. He played the whole second half last week with the injury. And Mike Shula just said, hey, we've got to try to get something going. There's a lot of football left, but we can't just keep going 3 and out. And so maybe number 12 can bring us a little magic on offense.
First and 20 from the 20. That's Sean Williams out of the backfield, wide to the left. Here's Croyle. Fires it behind Sean Williams. Mix up, and Croyle's injured. Yes, indeed.
He's down. I mean, you know, in Georgia, Brian Van Gorder went right after him. This is last week when he got hit by Tony Bua and then 3 other Arkansas players. That's when he injured the shoulder. But he came back in the second half and threw 3 touchdown passes. Played in pain, but it actually hurt worse the next morning than it did when he was playing. But, oh, man, you hate to see this.
Well, if you're down 30-3 on the road in the first half, I think there's some reason to question why put him back in.
And see, it's when he hit the ground with Odell Thurman. And you know, it's a brutal game. It's a vicious game, and Brian Van Gorder did the right thing. Go after him. And they blitzed the linebacker. It's not a heavy blitzing team, but they went after him right away. And Odell Thurman with the clean hit on Brody Croyle.
Thurman takes him down. Brody Croyle is out of the game. Second. Alabama faithful concerned now with their starting quarterback, Brody Croyle, back on the bench. Here's Pennington. back in the lineup, heaves it deep. Nice catch. The catch is made by Triandos Luke out to the 43-yard line. That is the first down of the game for Alabama, a gain of 25.
And the first breath of life into this Alabama offense. I mean, that was a nice throw, and it really was the result of good pass protection. I don't think that the offensive line has given Spencer Pennington or Brody Croyle, the play he was in, very much time to do anything in this first half. But that time, they held out the Georgia defenders and gave him time to see it and throw it downfield.
Gain of 25, Croyle up off the bench, but in such anguish. First down and 10. Yeah, there's offside.
Go ahead, stay with the play. Might get a bigger yardage. That's offsides clearly on Georgia. Nice job by Pennington staying with the play. And we saw him holding that left arm that way the whole second half last week. But he took a direct shot from Odell Thurman. And again, when he landed on the ground with Thurman on top of him, that's what really jolted that left shoulder.
Well, I asked a question, Todd, why play him in the second half, and you had an answer.
Well, it's 30-3, but it's still the second quarter. And Mike Shula's thinking, you know, hey, we still have a chance to try to get back in this game. If it's 30-3 in the fourth quarter, I don't think you take the risk of playing it. And you don't really know how he's going to respond to a hit. But obviously he didn't respond very well. But I think that's the reason he went with him, was trying to get something going, knowing there's still a lot of football left in this game.
Well, Jill Arrington reports from the sideline that they are searching for an X-ray now. That's the reason primarily that they're taking him into the locker room. Second and 3. Across midfield for only the second time for Alabama. They were there on the first series of the afternoon when Charles Jones intercepted David Greene to set up a field goal. Boy, it has been a tough afternoon for Shaud Williams, too.
Yeah. Well, the offensive line is getting beat up front. And Georgia is getting good penetration. They're fresh. Their defensive line is getting a good push. And they're not able to get this running game going. Here's kind of a scary nugget for Alabama that Santa Monica Chuck dug up a little bit ago. But since about 7 minutes and 21 seconds in the third quarter last week against Arkansas, when they led 31-10, Alabama has now been outscored 54-3 since that point. Not very good.
On third down, Pennington across the middle, Triandos Luke. That's good for a first down. Sean Jones over the back with the tackle, but they will get a fresh series.
And I've said something negative about the offensive line, another positive, another third down play. It starts with protection, and they give Spencer Pennington time. Watch, no red jerseys around Pennington. He's able to set his feet and make the nice throw to Triandos Luke, who beat Sean Jones on the play.
Back-to-back first downs for the Crimson Tide now. They trail 30-3 with 4:45 to go first half.
You know, we learned last week that when there's a lot of time left and you get down by a couple touchdowns, don't panic. Arkansas showed us that last week.
Here's Pennington, right side. Dre Fulgham, who had 2 touchdown catches last week. And that is a 3rd consecutive first down. That's a gain of 15 yards.
And Pennington looks completely different since he was out for a couple plays. Watch this. This is a corner blitz, and Pennington's going to see it and throw right in that area. As soon as he sees the blitz, he reads it. He calmly makes the throw into that open void, and it's a nice first down again for Alabama. But Spencer Pennington just looks so much more comfortable in the last few plays. 4-for-4 now on this Alabama drive.
First down inside the 30. Clock shows 4:07 remaining first half. Play fake. Right side, man coverage. Thornton is there. Flag is down. Catch was made out of bounds by Zach Fletcher. There is a flag in the secondary.
I think the penalty is going to be on the inside receiver on the tight end against Georgia, not on the intended receiver.
Defensive holding. First down, 18-yard line. 3:57 remaining in the half. stunts by the defensive line into the end zone. Pennington, touchdown!
What a drive by Spencer Pennington. Just when it looked the bleakest for Alabama, they put together an outstanding touchdown drive. 5 for 5, Spencer Pennington. Nice poise in the pocket, good protection. Dre Fulgham, who had 2 touchdown catches last week.
Now Spencer Pennington delivered just in time, it would appear. 7 plays, 70 yards, 3:03 off the clock. And Dre Fulgham on the receiving end of an 18-yard Spencer Pennington pass. Fulgham with the 2 catches last week from Brody Croyle. And now Pennington's 18-yard.
You know, and it's kind of crazy to suggest this, and you never like to see a guy get injured, but it's almost like the Brody Croyle injury woke up Alabama. Like something clicked when that happened. When he went off the field, Spencer Pennington was a different guy when he came on the field.
Kyle Robinson with the kick. It'll be taken at the 10-yard line. This is McClendon out to the 25.
Take another look at the touchdown. Here's Dre Fulgham right here. Now he's going to split these 2 safeties right here. And when those safeties split, Pennington makes the right read. He's going to see the middle of the field open up. And as soon as he sees Fulgham clear that linebacker, he sticks him with the football. I mean, this is an offense that had no first downs before that series, and they make 5 on that series. What a response. And it did. It started up front with that offensive line who had kind of gotten manhandled up to this point. After Brody Croyle got hit and knocked out of the game, they stepped up their game a little bit.
Lead is 20, high snap, controlled by Green. Screen pass, called, caught, Browning. He's dangerous when he gets in the open field, isn't he?
Yep.
That's the different dimension that he gives you. I mean, Musa Smith didn't have that dimension last year either. Tyson Browning is a smaller back, only 160, 165 pounds. But he's got that juke ability, that ability to make you miss, to plant his foot and go the other way. It's funny because the promos for this game on TV last week was Tyson Browning's in the Georgia Bulldogs, and his teammates gave him such a hard time. So Thursday, I'm on the practice field, and Mark Richt saw Tyson Browning and said, there he is, Tyson Browning in the Georgia Bulldogs. He just shook his head and walked away. So embarrassed.
Here's Green. He's got a man open. It's Johnson. Michael Johnson, who, if you join us late, is wearing number 4 today to honor his teammate Kentrell Curry, the defensive back, the senior whose season came to an end with an injury last week. Johnson, of course, will be a part of Georgia lore forever for the 13-catch effort he had in the win at Auburn last year, and, of course, the decisive play of the game, his reception of a 4th and 15 from 19 yards out to send Georgia to the SEC championship game. Here's Green, chased, throws it away. Another catch by Michael Johnson, but this time he was a participant. And Michael Johnson is split wide right. Jeremy Thomas back in as the fullback. And here's Green with a handoff. This is Greg Lumpkin.
One of the interesting matchups in this game from a coaching standpoint is Mark Richt, who is the play caller for Georgia, and Joe Kines, who's the defensive coordinator for Alabama. Joe Kines was on the Florida State staff for 3 years before coming to Alabama, and actually 1 year overlapped with Mark Richt there. And then last year, when Georgia played Florida State in the Sugar Bowl, they were matched up against each other there, too. So, Joe Kines was the linebacker coach at Florida State. Mickey Andrews, the longtime coordinator, but they went head-to-head there, and they're going at it again here today.
On 3rd and 9, here's Green. Got him!
Antoine Odoms is having a nice football game. I mean, he is coming hard off that edge. The second time he's been in there on the quarterback, and Alabama calls timeout, but watch Odom. He's beating the tight end, Ben Watson. See, that's a mismatch. Your best pass rusher, your leading career sack guy going against a tight end. You got to make sure you got a tackle on that guy or one of your best offensive linemen, not a tight end, especially a tight end who hasn't played for a couple weeks.
That is the second timeout used by Alabama. They have 1 remaining, and it's 4th and 18 now. And this will be Georgia's first punt of the game. 30-10. It'll be 4th down 18 when we return. back at Sanford Stadium on the campus at the University of Georgia in Athens. 30-10, Bulldogs lead, but about to give it up as Gordon Ely Kelso, who, like Billy Bennett, kind of ironic, was born and raised in Athens. They're both homegrown kids.
Both former soccer players, too. Excellent soccer players in high school. Alabama's coming after this when they're leaving the gunner free.
Flag.
They got some movement up front by Georgia, and this is why Mike Shula called the timeout, was to try to set up a punt block. See, it's 4th and 19, so even if you run into the kicker, that's not going
to
give Georgia the first
prior
down.
To the snap. False start against the offense. The penalty is 5 yards from the previous spot. Still 4th down.
See, they cleared off here. They brought him in. They're going to really go after Ely Kelso on this punt, and the movement up front cause somebody to move on the Georgia protection team. Now, do they do it again?
Shad Williams is awaiting the punt at the 15-yard line. Here is Ely Kelso. And they're dancing around, coming back up.
Personal protector for Georgia is the third-string quarterback.
That's Tereshinsky. Here's Ely Kelso. Shad Williams.
Now, that's a penalty.
Yep.
There is no halo rule anymore, but you have to give him an unimpeded opportunity to catch the football. And that was impeded. He caught it, but he was impeded.
Kenny Bailey, a cousin to the three members of the Bailey team who preceded it here at Georgia.
Yeah. Just got too close. I mean, he didn't hit him, but he got too close to him. Boos in the crowd, but I think that's the right call by this officiating crew. So that halo rule was hard to enforce, you know. Mm-hmm. You're 6 feet to him, you know, 2 yards, 3 yards, how far away are you? It's kind of subjective, but.
Well, the interference impeding the opportunity to complete the catch against the kicking team. The penalty is 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
They actually added yardage to the penalty this year, too, making it a 15-yard penalty. This is the right call. I mean, even though Shad Williams still made the catch, and even though Bailey didn't blow through him, you know, and pile drive him, he still was too close to him when he made the catch.
Now the crowd will try and affect the play. And Pennington, boy, Pennington drops the snap, and it is recovered by Georgia.
The snap was a little bit low. Pennington didn't field it cleanly. And all that work, you know, setting up the punt block, calling the timeouts, you got to catch the snap first. Quick pressure by the Georgia defense. It was a low snap, but as the quarterback, you got to just make the catch first, even if you fall on it right there.
92 seconds to go before the break, and David Greene, new opportunity now for Georgia. Up by 20 at this point. Here's Greene. Caught it at the 22, and let's go down to Jill Arrington for an update on Brody Croy.
Well, Vern, here's what I know about Brody. He's still in the locker room. He's still under evaluation, and they're telling me it does not look good, and he's very highly unlikely to return to the ball game.
Okay. Thanks, Jill. In for one series, playing with a separated left shoulder. Here's Greene again. Pressure. And it, not intercepted. Should have been.
Yep, Derek Pope read it beautifully and made a great break to the football, but just couldn't come down with the catch. Watch Derek Pope, number 6, read the quarterback. Again, Antoine Odom with the pressure got hands in the face of David Greene, and I don't think he saw Derek Pope.
3rd and 4. Greene, who has been intercepted once today, got a bit fortunate with that one. Quarterback draw. How about this for the brace?
Yeah.
And that was by design, don't you think?
Yeah, no. That was a called quarterback draw. You don't expect a quarterback with a hyperextended knee and a big brace on to run quarterback draw, so a good call by Mark Richt. Now, Georgia going hurry up. They've got all three of their timeouts left, so they don't have to rush everything.
Two wide receivers wide right. Here's a handoff to Tyson Browning. good. Derek Polk did a wonderful job.
Here comes a timeout for Georgia.
Timeout, Georgia.
Georgia with the timeout. They've got two remaining. Now, David Greene, hyperextended knee and all, said, I'll run it. First down. I just truly think this is one of the great venues in college football.
I absolutely agree. It is a beautiful campus, beautiful setting for college football.
Georgia's up by 20, and they've got a second down and 10. Roll out, David Greene, pressure from the backside, drills it, caught at the three. Mario Raley, number 80. Another one of those Todd mentioned earlier, back from an injury. That's a gain of 12. The clock's still running with 30. I beg your pardon. It stops on the first down.
Look at all the hands on the hips of the Alabama defenders. I mean, they are hanging on and glad Georgia called a timeout right now.
Georgia has one remaining. Seconds to go before the break. It's 30-10 and a first and goal. Georgia. David Greene in the first half has found 9 different receivers. He will send Damian Gary and Michael Johnson wide to the left, and he'll go from the shotgun.
I think you got to watch Tyson Browning here out of the backfield. Little pick play to the left.
He's at Greene's left right now. That's Gary in motion. They look for Tyson Browning, instead find the tight end. It is a touchdown, Georgia. Ben Watson, 3 yards.
Well, Ben Watson is going to come right over to here, okay? And Browning is going to go out in the flat, and that's where David Greene looks first. They set a pick for Browning. It's not there, and there comes the tight end right into that soft spot. What a turnaround. The fumbled snap by Spencer Pennington. And Georgia, as a great team should, takes full advantage, 37-10.
Senior Ben Watson, much missed by his teammates when he was out with an injury, comes back and gets his first touchdown catch of the season. Yeah.
And they missed him for his talent, obviously, but also for his presence. I mean, he's the only senior starter on this offensive football team. And Damian Gary is a senior, but he's not considered a starter. He's kind of the number 3 receiver. But Ben Watson, the starting tight end and a senior, and they missed his leadership on the field and in the huddle.
Billy Bennett with the kickoff. 37-10. Ray Hudson has it for the Crimson Tide of Alabama, and he's tackled at the 25-yard line. Well, time now for the coach's decision.
Well, they went to play Brody Croyle. They were down 30-3. A lot of time left. He played 2 plays. In the second play, he got hit by Odell Thurman and re-injured that separated left shoulder. And a lot of questions. You know, was it a good decision or the right decision by Mike Shula? And it was a hard decision because, you know, he played the whole second half with the injury last week and threw 3 touchdown passes and almost won the game.
Here's Pennington back and connects with Fulgham out of the right flat. That'll be down at the 30-yard line. Clock still running. Alabama with 1 timeout left.
Just to follow up on that with Croyle, we mentioned that he originally injured it in Oklahoma. So he's played the whole season pretty much with a bad left shoulder. Was he going to injure it worse by playing today? Mike Shula didn't know. He got his answer in 2 plays, though.
David Pollack told us yesterday that his coaches, Mark Richt and Brian Van Gorder, have said to him, listen, loosen up. Have some fun. He is. Let's go down to Jill Arrington with Mike Shula.
Now, Coach Shula, I know you were down by 27, but I got to ask you the question. Why did you decide to put an injured Brody into the game?
Well, we felt like he was going to play either way, and we felt like we were going to have to throw the ball, and, you know, we felt like he was going to give us our best chance to do that. Now, obviously, didn't turn out to be the right decision because on second play we get sacked and he gets hit again. So hopefully he's not hurt too badly, but Spence came back in We got the drive going, but you know, we're killing ourselves against a good football team. It's a bottom line. And you can't do that. You can't have block punt. You can't two fumbles, and they're good as it is. And you know, we just got to somehow regroup and keep our poise, keep our composure, and come out and fight like mad the second half.
All right, coach. Good luck. Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Jill. We're at the half here at Athens, Georgia, 37-10. Let's go back to New York and Tim Brandon. Sellout crowd at Sanford Stadium on the campus of the University of Georgia, and they are enjoying the Bulldogs 37-10 lead as we get set for the start of quarter number three. Billy Bennett, who has authored three field goals in the first half, will kick off. Ray Hudson, one of the deep men. He is joined deep for Alabama by Ramsey Robinson. 37-10. Georgia in command, trying to go 4-1 for the season. And the kick from Bennett. Left side again. And Ramsey Robinson follows Hudson's block. Is tripped up by the ankle and out of bounds in the vicinity of the 30-yard line. Of course, the big factor for Alabama in the first half, Brody Croyle's injury, looked like he re-injured the shoulder separation, gone for the game. What do they do now?
Well, they've got to just try to play 30 minutes, and they can't worry about Brody Croyle's injury right now. I mean, there's nothing they can do for him, nothing he can do for their team. They've got to rally behind Spencer Pennington, who showed some life there with their touchdown drive. And really, you know, you take away that fumbled snap, Alabama had fought their way back into this ballgame. Even though they were down by 20, they still had some life. But that fumble before the end of the half really hurt.
Spencer Pennington on. He did start today and gave way for the one series to Brody Croyle. Sean Jones knocks that one down.
You take a look at the numbers. I mean, highlighted right there, almost 300 yards of offense for Georgia. They ran twice as many plays as Alabama in that first half. It was a dominant effort by Alabama, I mean by Georgia, offense and defense in that first half.
37 points is the most ever scored by a Georgia team in the series with Alabama. Most ever. 37-10, second down and 10. Blitz, Pennington back. There comes David Pollock. The pass is up for grabs, deep and incomplete at the 35-yard line. Intended for Fulgham, and Bruce Thornton was there to knock it down. David Pollock with 14 sacks a year ago. He has one half of one sack thus far this season. But numbers don't tell the story.
No, they don't with a guy like him. You see, he's there a hair late. He puts a big hit on the quarterback. His presence is felt. He hasn't had the numbers. But you know what? When he gets double teamed, or when they chip on him, that means they're blocking one-on-one on other guys that are having a chance to make plays.
Third and 10. Comes the push. They got him. Thomas Davis, who is the free safety and lines up as a rush end on third downs. And Pennington is hurt.
I really love watching Pollock and this Thomas Davis. I mean, he is just so fast. He comes from the outside, and Evan Mathis has no chance. I mean, he's so quick off the ball. He's anticipating the snap count, and that first step is what beats the tackle.
Here's the punt. Fair catch call that will bounce away from Damian Gary and limp across the 25-yard line. Comes to a rest at the 23-and-a-half.
This defensive front seven for Georgia has been impressive today. And they gave up the one touchdown drive. But David Pollock and that defense with a couple new linebackers in there today, and Derek White and Danny Verdun-Wheeler, they have just they have not given Alabama much opportunity to do anything.
Now, you have heard us tell the story many times in the last year and a half. David Pollock and David Greene, best friends since they were 7 years old, played peewee football together. They are now roommates, which is really kind of like Oscar and Felix. And roommates and best friends, I would just guess, and it's just a guess, but I think the quarterback is the more tidy of the two.
Well, Well, I mean, it just it just goes to figure. I mean, most quarterbacks are very meticulous, well-dressed, mannered type people.
And I led you into it. 37-10, Georgia in command over an Alabama team whose quarterback, Brody Croyle, did not start this because of a separated shoulder, played one series, re-injured the shoulder, will not be back. Here's David Greene on play action on first down, deep left side. That one, a little mix-up with Fred Gibson. And defensively, Charles Jones, who picked off Greene in the first series of the game, was closest to the ball for Alabama.
Well, this is the freshest that we might see this Alabama defense because they had the halftime break, you know, and then their offense was on the field first to start the third quarter. So they got a little bit of a respite there.
Second and 10. And shotgun. There's Greene rolling to his left, being chased by Freddie Roach, and he throws it away. David Greene, who just doesn't give it up very much, had an unusual number of three turnovers in that game 2 weeks ago against LSU. Here's the first, a fumble.
Yeah, a fumble in the red zone. I mean, they were driving in the first half, and then an interception that went off the helmet of one of his teammates. And then this is just a great play by Corey Webster, the best cover corner for LSU. It wasn't necessarily a bad choice or a bad throw, but a great play by Webster.
And the numbers for today, just 5 yards shy of 200 yards throwing for David Greene. West Tanner snaps it back, and here's Greene. He'll take off. D'Amico Ryans gets him and tackles him at the 28-yard line.
This D'Amico Ryans is a fun football player to watch. And Joe Kine said he's what every coach wished that he could have. He's a guy that gets good grades in the classroom. He never says a word. He's very well. He came to Alabama very well coached, very fundamentally sound. Played at Jess Lanier High School in Bessemer, Alabama. All his family grew up Auburn fans. They were all Bo Jackson fans. And he went to Alabama.
Five tackles today. He had 25 last week in that double overtime loss to Arkansas. That is a new regular season Alabama single game record. Here's the punt by Ethan Kelso, and boy, he nailed this. Shawn Williams.
Boy, what a punt.
Isn't that something?
That was a bomb. Man.
Gordon Ely Kelso, first year as the punter for Georgia, replacing Jonathan Kilgo, who had that chore for 4 years. That is a 64-yard punt. Chapel Bell near Hurdy Field, and those kids getting the ride of their lives, aren't they?
Yeah. That's a pretty neat deal.
Hang on tightly. After that 64-yard punt, first down, Spencer Pennington started this game in a very inefficient first quarter and a half, and then led Alabama in the touchdown drive that Shawn Williams nailed again. Let's go down and check in with Jill Arrington on injuries. Jill?
Well, back on the sidelines, Brody Croyle, he's in street clothes. They have a sling on his arm. He did re-separate that left shoulder. It's a big loss for Alabama. But on the other side of the ball, there's many injuries for Georgia. Daniel Inman is out of the game. He has an ankle and a knee injury. Josh Brock has a shoulder injury. Tony Milton, you haven't seen him a lot today because that leg is sore again. Quentin Moses, his ice on his right elbow, and Kenny Veal with that left ankle. So they're pretty banged up, doing the best they can.
All right, thank you, Jill. Sounds like you've got a walk-on roll in General Hospital. Second down and 15 from the end zone. Pennington fires it, caught by Brandon Greer out to the 27-yard line. That's a gain of 21.
Good protection up front. I mean, it hasn't been all that consistent for Alabama up front, but this time they give Pennington time, and that deep in route has been his most productive throw. You can see Pennington has talent as a thrower. He's got a strong arm. He's got a nice delivery. Gets rid of the ball fairly quickly. He's now 8 for 15 in the ball game.
And a first down and 10 after the 21-yard lead. Here's Shawn Williams.
This is the problem for Alabama.
Ray Hudson.
They just have nothing going running the football. This is a team coming in that averaged almost 170 yards a game rushing, and Shaun Williams is one of the best players in the entire conference, and they've just got nothing, minus 7 yards rushing. Now, obviously, the sacks count into that, but they just have had nothing going with their running game, and therefore, one of the best players in the country has been a non-factor in this game, Shaun Williams.
Shaun Williams, who earlier this year against Kentucky had 174 yards on the ground and has twice this season already been named SEC Offensive Player of the Week. He's 6 for -1 today. Here's Pennington under pressure from Pollock. Deep right side, that one up for grabs, and it is going to be picked off out of bounds. All right, thank you, Tim. 37-10 here, 3rd and 10, Alabama.
Well, if you're Alabama, you better make sure you find out where Thomas Davis is and you get somebody that gets out of his stance to block him.
He's on the near side. Here he comes. And the pressure from the other side is there as well. Fulgham to the 31. It'll be 4th down. A flag is down.
This is one of the only things that Georgia has done poorly today, is I think that's their 8th penalty in the ball game. And Greg Blue, who is his first game back from a knee injury that he injured in training camp, anxious to get back on the field and a little over anxious on that tackle. He's a physical safety, and really when he got injured, that's when Thomas Davis had to move back, because Kentrell Curry got hurt first and then Greg Blue got hurt second. Now here's Thomas Davis from a stand-up rush position, and Wesley Britt, who's an All-American, does a nice job, and what he did was he got out of his stance quickly. And he didn't take any false steps, because if you hesitate at all against him, he's going to blow by you.
And after the penalty, it'll be 3rd and 2. There's Thomas Davis. Mark Richt following the sideline. 3rd down, 2, Alabama.
And the play clocks both say, oh, there they go, they just reset them.
Shaun Williams and Tim Castile are in the backfield. Here's Williams, and he's tackled by Derek White as he gets to the 40, but that's going to be good for a 1st down. And Shaun Williams, on his 7th carry, finally gets into the positive yardage area.
See, the problem, if you can't get anything going with him running it, then you've got to throw the ball to him, you know, and they've tried to throw a couple screens in Georgia. Georgia just doesn't get fooled by very much. They are so well coached defensively and so well disciplined. They stay in the right places. You know, they're a different philosophy. They're not a heavy blitz type team, not a heavy man-to-man team, but they're very, very well schooled.
1st down and 10. Play fake, Pennington. He wants to go deep, and he goes deep into double coverage for Zach Fletcher. It's intercepted by DeCorey Bunn. 1st interception of the year for number 22.
This is excellent coverage by DeCorey Bryant, because he did not fight on the double move. They tried to go a double fade, and the ball was thrown too far inside, for one thing. I mean, there was safety help coming over, but Pennington has to keep that ball a little bit further outside. But DeCorey Bryant was not fooled by the double move and stayed in great place to make the interception.
3rd Alabama turnover of the day. Georgia has the ball when we return. University of Georgia has a great football tradition, and among the most noteworthy accomplishments in the long history of this football program, the Heisman Trophy awarded to Herschel Walker after the 1982 season. 41 Georgia records, 16 SEC records, and a terrific professional career after that. And Herschel Walker is among those who is enjoying this one today. That's kind of a tease to indicate that he's going to join us in just a second. 1st down and 10. And DJ Shockley is back in the lineup. 1st action in this half. Had an effective appearance in the 2nd half, and that pass is incomplete as DJ Shockley goes after Damian Gary. Well, Todd and I have been joined by the 1982 Heisman Trophy winner. Good
well,
to see
should,
you again.
We shouldn't say 82. That's a long time.
Only from your perspective.
Oh, okay.
Well, I know you were present at the Alabama-Georgia game a year ago. That one was a little tighter than this.
Well, it was. I tell you, I think Alabama's had a tough road, and Georgia had a week off. And Alabama also got a lot of injuries. So that, I think, that plays a big role today.
Here's the second down and 10 play as DJ Shockley, who had that touchdown in the first half, hands it off on the left side, a gain of a couple after the 17. Well, bring us up to date. What are you up to now?
Right now, I have a company called Herschel Famous 34 Appetizers. I do appetizers all
around. There's the promo.
And oh yeah, that's right, through Cisco. But what's weird is I'm working. I also have a four-year-old little boy. I think that's probably my biggest job right there, is trying to raise him and do the right thing with him.
Are you still working out yourself?
I'm working out all the time. You know, I say I'm going to be the George Foreman of football. When I'm a 50, I'm going to make a comeback and try to come back and play again.
Where are you living?
I'm living in Dallas, Texas. I'm still out there with the Cowboys, and, you know, they're playing well right now, so that's a good thing.
Third and nine, and here's the snap back to Shockley, who wants to put it on his hip and run. And that'll bring up fourth down.
Official, obviously you played for the legendary Vince Dooley, Mark Richt, the new head coach here. What do you think of him and the kind of football Georgia's playing right now?
Well, Georgia really needed a coach like Coach Richt, a guy that brought back discipline like Coach Dooley had, a guy that made the guys work, because you can't beat hard work, and the guys love it. I think when he first came in, the guys were real skeptical about what Coach Richt was doing, but now everyone believes in him, and he's the type of coach that they need.
You got any memories of this guy in
well,
a ball game?
Well, you know what? They beat us in the Sugar Bowl, and I'm not liking him too much right now, but now since he's up here working, it's okay.
Oh.
I say a lot of nice things about Georgia these days.
Oh, that's great.
Here's Gordon Ealy-Kelso, low snap. He picks it up, and the punt. Shawn Williams is back, grabs it at the 43-yard line, heads to his right, and is down at the 49-yard line. Well, we want to thank you so much for what you did for college football, and to see you again back here on campus.
Hey, thank you now.
All right, Herschel. Time has been called. We'll be right back. First and 10, ball at the 50, Spencer Pennington. And a quarterback started the game, gave way briefly to Brody Coyle, who re-injured his left shoulder and is out for the game. And here is Shawn Williams. And let's go down and check in once again with Jill Arrington. Jill.
Well, Vern, Coach Shula might be facing a lot of adversity with his team, and after that tough game last week, he had something extra special to look forward to after the game. He and his wife, Sherry, went straight to the DCH Medical Center following the game and had a new baby girl, their second. They named her Dorothy Brooke. Dorothy, after his mom, 6 pounds, 10 ounces, and 19 inches. After such a close game, I can see why the wife wanted to go into labor then, but we offer them great congratulations.
All right, Jill, that was their daughter, Samantha, who was three, who was also a part of the family picture. Second down. Shawn Williams. Mike Shula, we were chatting with him in Tuscaloosa last week, and he said actually he and Sherry had planned the birth of their child for a Dolphins off week.
Yeah, well, I asked him, I said, you've been in football and around football long enough. I mean, how'd you mess up the timing on this one? And he said, well, we really didn't, because when we first found out we were pregnant, it was scheduled to be on the week of the Dolphins off week in the NFL. And once he took the Alabama job, there was no change in the other deal.
No, hard to affect that change. Here's first down. And Pennington escapes the sack, goes deep, and it's incomplete as Fulgham is hit. We shall. 37 to 10 here, 6:54 to go, and second down and 10.
Thomas Davis is on the edge again. Down the bottom of the screen.
Here
look out. Comes,
and the blitz, and there's Davis, and it's tipped and almost intercepted. Tipped, and Tim Jennings was very, very, very close. The heading all the way to the end zone, and Pennington is hurt.
Well, Pennington took a shot from Thomas Davis, and nobody blocked him. It's play action away from him, and he's so fast that he got there so quickly, and it's just the driving down, and I think that might be Pennington's shoulder. Only I think it's his right shoulder that hit the ground hard there.
And the backup is a true freshman out of high school from Tuscaloosa named Brandon Avalos. Has yet to play this year, but maybe moments away from his first appearance.
Well, he's played a lot more as a baseball player at Alabama than a football player. He started 15 games as an outfielder for Alabama last spring. And he's doing a smart thing here, taking a few snaps.
Spencer Pennington remains on the ground. And in obvious pain. All right, Brandon Avalos still on the sideline. Spencer Pennington walking off unaided, but favoring that right shoulder. Brody Coyle gets a little chance to give some encouragement to Avalos. It's third down.
You know, and he just kind of slapped him upside the head a minute ago and just said, hey, go out there and have fun. You know, just go out there and play and have fun. Here he is. He just, you know, Brody Croyle, a team guy. He said, hey, don't cut it loose, man. Don't be conservative now. We're down 37-10. Go out there and let it rip.
Brandon Avalos, first snap for Alabama. Draw play. Sean Williams goes right, darts back to the left, struggles. It'll be fourth down and two.
Pretty nice call there on that third down. You know that you're having trouble blocking Thomas Davis off the edge, so you let him rush up. You invite that outside rush and you slip the draw in behind him, and Sean Williams fights to get close to the first down.
Now here's one of the problems that Mike Shula confronts as Pennington continues to get medical help. We talked to him about Brandon Avalos earlier in the week. He said, man, he's got no reps in practice at all. So we've just got to go conservative, really shorten the playlist. It's fourth and one here. They'll throw it. Avalos's first throw is complete.
How about that? Good for him.
Lance Taylor made the grab. It's first down, Alabama.
Last week on Spencer Pennington's first throw, it was third and six at a critical time right before the half. Here's a fourth down play. They sprint him out, gets his shoulders turned around, and makes a nice throw to Lance Taylor. And Taylor secured the catch. He wasn't going to drop this one. Went up and wrapped both arms around it. And Alabama lives to play another down.
With a first and 10, big Wesley Britt, all 6'8", will try and protect the 6-foot freshman quarterback, Brandon Avalos.
Play clock down to five now. They're not going to get this one off.
Nope.
You know, he's got so much in his mind right now. The last thing he's thinking about is the play clock. I mean, he wants to make sure he's got all his equipment on. He's got his helmet buckled down, got the play call, knows the protections. Oh, yeah. I forgot. I got to remember about the play clock, too.
Spencer Pennington, apparently right shoulder. Flag down for delay of game. Pennington for the day, 9 of 20 for 109 yards. Had one touchdown and was intercepted once. It's a tough game, isn't it? Here's Avalos on first and 15. David Cavan, the tight end. And off. Here's Hudson coming left. Hudson into the secondary inside the 20 and down at the 14-yard line by Odell Thurman. That's a 17-yard gain for Hudson.
And see, this is what Alabama had been doing prior to the injury to Brody Coyle. They've been moving and shifting and changing strength, and that was what Brian Van Gorder was afraid of with some of these younger players. And that time, they just outflanked him. They switched strength, they moved their tight end, they went with some motion, and they caught Georgia outnumbered on the short side of the field and got a nice run.
First down and 10.
Two tight ends in the game again for Alabama, a running formation.
Draw play. Sean Williams coming left. Avalos quickly goes over to the far hash mark, puts his hands on his hips, and asks for the next play to be signaled in.
And Brian Van Gorder said that's enough with the backups, and David Pollock and Robert Gethers are back in the game. So they were getting a little bit of a break there. And Alabama ran a couple counter traps right at those two new defensive ends and knocked them out of there. And Van Gorder said, that's it. Get back in there, guys.
Second and six. officially at the 10. High formation with Castillo, the freshman, another true freshman, the blocker. Here's play action. Castillo makes the grab, and a nice open field stop by DeCorey Bryant, who kind of emulated a crab as he continued toward the sidelines.
See, watch what Brandon Avalos is doing now. He's going to the sideline to get every play. See, they're not sending in. They're sending the quarterback over there to make sure they get the play. You mentioned it. It'll be a much limited, more limited playlist for Brandon Avalos. This is big here. Third and six from the 10. Georgia doesn't have to defend depth. Might see another sprint out again.
Straight drop back. Up, fires, drop.
Oh, he's got to catch it.
Yep.
That's a good throw. Again, David Cavan has a bad right thumb, and he's having trouble catching the football. And here's they're going to go for it on fourth down. But this is a good throw by Avalos. There's Cavan coming right at you. Good timing throw. Before he came out of his break, he's just got to secure that catch. But it's hard when you got a banged up thumb.
That's a couple of times that thumb has affected David Cavan's ability to catch the football. Fourth and six.
Well, that was a good play call, good execution.
Four-man rush. Here's Avalos, darts, stop short, ball goes over on downs.
They ran the same play. I mean, I think that was the same play, but this time Avalos tried to run for it, and if he doesn't stumble a little bit, he might pick up this first down, but this is such a fast Georgia defense. Watch as he tucks it and goes. He's going to stumble right there. And that little stumble slowed him down just enough that he didn't get to the first down marker.
The ball goes over on downs, and Georgia holds on to a 37-10 lead. They've got the ball at their own 7-yard line. Tyson Browning, Jeremy Thomas in the backfield. Green rolls out to his right, fires it. Caught up at the 16-yard line. Catch made by Fred Gibson.
Fred's been back today, but he's been pretty quiet. You know, he just doesn't seem to have the same burst, the same bounce that he's had when he's been healthy. I think Ben Watson has been probably more of a factor in his return than Fred Gibson. Gibson, four catches, only 28 yards. He came in averaging over 20 a catch.
Second down and one. It's a long one at the 16-yard line. Green hands it off. That'll be good for a first down.
Really proud of Kerry Collins, former Penn State quarterback who overcame a lot of things in his early in his career down in Carolina, and he's done a great job for the Giants.
First and 10, Georgia blitz coming. What a good blitz pickup by Tyson Browning. And it's man for man down the left side. I'll tell you, that's an incomplete pass. Tyson Browning did a terrific job.
He sure did. 160-pounder, and this is the thing that Mark Richt said, hey, it's not about who can just run the football, it's who can protect the quarterback. He's blocking against Roman Harper. Right there it is. And Tyson Browning did not shy away from it. Stuck his nose right in there and stayed with the block. See the second effort? Never left his man. That's why, you know, when you talk about running backs, it's not just what they do with the ball in their hands. It's what they do without the football. And blocking is a big part of that.
Second down and 10. And there's another good block in the left tackle spot. Tyson Browning gets out to the left.
I'll never forget the funniest line I ever heard Lou Holtz say about his time in Minnesota. He said, great people up there. Everybody has blonde hair and blue ears.
Intercepted. Picked off by Alabama. Charles Jones.
Uh-oh. Wow.
Well, well, well.
Oh, David Greene is just sick at himself. You just don't see David Greene make too many bad decisions of where to throw the football, but he threw this one into traffic. And take a look, Charles Jones, number 20. He gets right out in that area, and he came from inside That was an excellent call by Joe Kynes. They guessed right. They anticipated where David Greene was going to go with that football, and they jumped right on it.
Ryan Bostic for the extra point, a 30-yard interception and the return for the touchdown for Charles Jones. Good job of holding, and the snap is no, the kick is no good. Bad snap, down low. Time now for the Fidelity Investment scoring summary. It opened with a field goal from Ryan Bostic, and then Billy Bennett, who had missed three last week, kicked three in a row to make it 9-3. There was a block from Georgia, recovered by Thomas Davis, 17-10, and then Georgia pretty much held its own. Here's Lumpkin for three. Partial comeback as Dre Fulgen made a catch, but Watson countered for Georgia, 37-10. And then just moments ago, David Greene picked off by Charles Jones, who returned it officially 30 yards for the touchdown. So we stand at 37-16 after the missed extra point. All right, thank you, Tim. And Atlas Herrien has been helped to a sitting position now, being assisted to his feet. Earlier this week, when we talked with Mike Shula, we said, who's playing well? And he picked Atlas Herrien as among those who has really contributed.
Played two positions last week, and a lot of minutes, a lot of snaps. It was good to see him walking off the field.
Walking off with Dennis Alexander. Atlas Herrien redshirted a year ago, having come in 2 years ago from junior college.
Well, just going back to that touchdown, the interception, you know, you just don't see David Greene get fooled too many times, but they fooled him because, see, this looks like man-to-man with a free safety. But watch Charles Jones. He's going to break right away for that spot. It's a zone defense. It looks like man, and he breaks right there, and David Greene thought it was single coverage, and Charles Jones just picked his pocket. I mean, that was an excellent disguise of the defense by Alabama.
Kyle Robinson getting ready to kick off. 37-16, 106 to go, third quarter. And Lumpkin and Brian McClendon are the two deep men.
Lumpkin and McClendon are deep. Robinson to kick off.
McClendon picks it up.
How many times did you see that? Yep. That ball bounced and stayed right there. Brian McClendon and probably everybody else thought it was for certain going to kick out of bounds, and that ball just, man, just died. I wish my wedge shots would do that.
And let's go down to Jill Arrington. Jill?
Unfortunately for Alabama, their second quarterback is out for the game with a shoulder injury. Spencer Pennington's, though, is his right throwing arm. He's got the pads off. They put ice on the shoulder, and he's out for the game, guys.
All right, Jill, thank you. The list grows for both teams. Here's Tyson Browning goes around the end. Now down the 2 yard line. Flags are down.
Well, Georgia has had to battle some sloppiness here in the second half. They have not looked anything like they did in that first half.
That'll be a reason for coaching. So Mark Richt will have their attention when this one is over. 37-16. Here's
during the run, holding against the offense. The penalty is half the distance to the goal. Still first down.
Looked like it might have been Dennis Rowland, who's in at right tackle and was helping lead the way around the corner. First and 18, ninth penalty on Georgia for the day. Final 50 seconds, quarter number three. Four-man Alabama rush. Green flips it out. One hopper for Tyson Brown.
This Alabama football team, I'm amazed at their resiliency. I mean, over everything they've been through over the last couple years, and we've seen a lot of these players play for the last couple years, this is a resilient group of young men. I mean, and there's no quit in them. They were tired in the first half. They're not tired right now. And they're still playing because they know they were in a game last week where they had a 21-point lead in the third quarter and lost. So they know it can be done.
Here's Green under pressure, deep for Gary. Damian Gary, yes, it was.
What a throw. D'Amico Ryans was right underneath coverage in good position. And David Greene put that ball in the only place that he could, right over the linebacker and right in front of the safety for the first down.
Damian Gary with the catch for 26 yards. And the ball first down and 10 at the 33-yard line now in the final 20 seconds of quarter number three. Blitz coming. Green doesn't see it. Got him. That came from Juwan Garth, number 42.
Yeah, you're right. He didn't see it. Juwan Garth is up here. He's going to come unblocked. Actually, Dennis Rowland tried to block him and didn't do a very good job of it.
Loss of 10, final play, third quarter. That is the end of three. And we'll return to Stanford Stadium right after this message and a word from your local station. Things have gone the way of the Bulldogs today, 37-16. August 6, by the way, is a fifth-year senior.
Okay.
Ball on the 23 on second down and 10. Here's Browning. Out to the 23-yard line. And we begin the fourth quarter in a game dominated by the Georgia Bulldogs. The injury list still mounting. But Georgia, I think, is they're not going to be real happy with things. But no, learned a little bit.
Not the third quarter. First two quarters, they were outstanding. But the third quarter, only 36 yards of offense. They were sloppy. David Greene, uncharacteristically, throws the interception that was returned for the touchdown. And they're allowing Alabama, as undermanned as they are, with their third-team quarterback, they're allowing them to feel like they can still make a run at them here in the fourth quarter. So the key for Georgia, I think, in the fourth quarter is offensive execution.
Third and 20. On the second play, here's David Greene back, has some time. Odom Green goes deep. Diving try by McClendon. It is incomplete. It'll be fourth down.
Boy, he had him. I mean, there was a big opening there, and it would have been probably a first down. McClendon found a nice hole between the corner and the safety, but just a short throw by David Greene. And again, McClendon has not played much, so the timing with David Greene, not really good at this point.
And Gordon Ely Kelso is on to punt for the fourth time. He's just had a terrific season, and it grows today. Three punts for 47-yard average.
And Shaud William, who has been kind of quiet today, always dangerous. He fumbled the snap.
Picked
up. Alabama's got it.
Yes, they do.
Oh, boy.
Juwan Garth has scored.
Oh, boy. Their offense hasn't been able to do a lot, but their defense scored a touchdown, and now their special team have scored a touchdown. Lack of concentration. Ever since Georgia came out of the locker room, they have not concentrated or executed. That was a good snap. It was not caught, and Juwan Garth puts Alabama on the scoreboard again.
Extra point try. Ryan Bostic. Up and good.
Point after it, good.
Well, how about that? Picked up by Juwan Garth, who scoots in for the score. Crimson Tide fans have reason to wave the flags and throw the pom-poms in the air. Gordon Ely Kelso, like Todd said during the break, it was a kiss of death. Bragged about how good he's playing.
He had been having a good game to that point, but he just flat out dropped that one.
A 10-yard fumble return for a touchdown, and Robinson will kick off now for the Crimson Tide. 14-point game with a lot of time left, and oh,
bad play there by Robinson. You don't want to give him the ball in a 35. I mean, let's take a look at what happened. It's a little bit of a low snap, but Eli Kelso's got to catch that. Went right through his hands. I mean, never even had a hand on it, and then got bobbled around a couple times. And Jawan Garth, who's had an outstanding football game, the redshirt freshman out of Decatur, with the touchdown.
There's Eli Kelso, who gets to think about all of that for a while now. First downs, Georgia 17 in the first half, only two in this half. And DJ Shockley is back in at quarterback. Grounding in motion, blitz coming, and it's dropped.
Incomplete.
Close to a lateral. Well, time now for the SEC Sonic Moment. Let's go down and spend some time with Jill Arrington.
Well, Vern, Mike Shula is definitely no stranger to this rivalry. With Shula at the helm, it turned out to be a classic game. He hit Bell for a 16-yard touchdown in the second quarter. Georgia hung tough, scoring on a blocked punt with 50 seconds left in the game, putting the Bulldogs up 16-13. But Shula wasn't done. He directed the Tide on a five-play, 71-yard drive that culminated in his second TD pass to Al Bell. Alabama wins it 20-16.
All right, thank you, Jill. Oh, my goodness, there's Shockley with a fumble and a scramble. And it appears that Georgia held on.
You know, one of the problems for Mark Richt right now is when you lose your edge and when you lose your enthusiasm and your emotion, it's really hard to get it back. And right now, we are seeing a very flat, disjointed Georgia football team. I mean, they don't look like they looked anything like they looked in the first half. It's very hard to turn that back on after it's gotten turned off. And meanwhile, those guys in the white jerseys, they've got a little bit of something going on right now.
Third and 12, huge play in this ballgame. Here's Shockley, left side. Johnson caught behind the line. It'll be fourth down. Anthony Madison made the tackle. How do you do?
This defense that was hanging on in the first half has new life in their legs. Anthony Madison fought through the block, sure tackle. And now Eli Kelso has to catch this one first before he does anything.
Snapper is Brian Jordan. Last one was bobbled, returned for the touchdown by Jawan Garth.
I'd set up Shaud Williams on this one. I mean, I would let 21 get a good return if you can.
I think that's what they've got in mind. Here's the punt, fairly short.
Very short.
Out of bounds at the 38-yard line. That is his least effective punt. And I would imagine bothered by the fumble on the previous play. 33-yard punt. The margin of difference is now 14 with 12:24 to go. Fourth quarter of play, Georgia clings to a 37-23, and you say lead, and you say clings because things have shifted certainly toward the Alabama side. First down and 10. Avalos back under some pressure, fires it out incomplete at the 40-yard line. Well, Jill brought you the highlights of that 1985 game here when Mike Shula led the comeback. Mike was sharing with us his most vivid memory of the game. His late mother, Dorothy, who died of cancer in 1991, was here for that game 18 years ago. She got so nervous as things were progressing that she left her seat in the stands and went down and began to walk behind the hedges, not between. And he said she never saw anything in the last minute and a half of the game except the ball in the air. She couldn't see any of the players. Here's Shaud Williams out to the 44-yard line.
Said she was only 5'4", so that is why she couldn't see over the hedges. But take a look at teams on the road, and Alabama won 5 of 6 on the road last year. They lost to Oklahoma the first week of the season out in Norman, and then won every other road game, including all of their SEC games last year.
Well, if you're a fan of big plays in ball games, this is one you might circle.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Third and 4. In a 14-point game with Brandon Avalos getting the blitz and running it. Oh, he was tripped up. It was loose, and this one's going to be ruled down.
Oh, and they had it. This was a blitz by Georgia going after the third-team quarterback, and it was a called quarterback draw away from the blitz. I mean, watch the blitz coming here, and Avalos has got a lane right there, and he just trips up. He tripped himself. I don't even think anybody hit him. He just kind of got his feet tangled up. He would have had the first down, but he just slipped and fell.
Now Bo Freeland, who's had one punt block in return for a touchdown, sends this one deep. Damian Gary awaits it. Flag.
Well, that wasn't a very smart penalty there either. I think it was Thurman Ward who's the gunner, and you know, he peeled off and he just kind of lost his balance and bumped into Damian Gary. Didn't knock him down, didn't hit him, but he bumped into him, and it's going to give George a better field position.
Kick catch interference against the kicking team, impeding the opportunity to complete the catch. The penalty is 15 yards. By rule.
Well, we saw one against Georgia, and now we see one against Alabama. You've got to give him free ability to catch the football. And see, I thought he did have a chance to make the catch, but he did run into him after the fair catch signal. Anyway, 15 yards for Georgia is the result.
Time call. All right, Tim, thank you. See, this shot is, if you're only 5'4",
yeah,
and you're trying to watch your son play football, you need a step ladder.
Yeah, those are thick hedges. You're not going to see between them either. I mean, you stand on somebody's back or...
First down and 10. 10:55 to go after that 15-yard penalty. David Greene and the Georgia Bulldogs have a first down at the 33. Craig Lumpkin is the running back, and here's Greene. Got some pressure, fires it behind Damian Gary, incomplete. Friday on CBS, whether it's a drug ring or a bank robbery, the FBI's undercover team will take on any identity to solve crimes from the inside. Emmy winner Joe Pantoliano is the handler. Don't miss an all-new episode Friday at 10, 9 Central on CBS.
You know, one thing that it feels like that's happening with Alabama defensively right now is they're playing a little bit more the style that LSU played against Georgia 2 weeks ago. They didn't earlier in the game, but they are playing more aggressive, more bump and run, more blitz.
Up the middle it goes, Lumpkin. Out to the 40-yard line.
Brought down. We've seen a lot of Craig Lumpkin today. We haven't seen any of Michael Cooper. He had a little knee injury in the LSU game, and they're resting him today. So Lumpkin getting a lot more work. Nice job by the youngster protecting the football, because the last thing Georgia needs right now is another turnover. And he did a nice job of covering up that ball with both arms when he knew he was going to get hit.
Lumpkin came in with 8 carries for the season, 9 already this afternoon. Third and 4. Here's Green looking near side. He finds Fred Gibson. That appears to be enough to move the chain. First and 10, Charlie Pepper, number 26. Georgia does convert. And that'll buy him a couple of minutes on the clock as well.
Well, there's some people that may have turned this game, or Alabama fans maybe have stopped watching. But right back in the game. One guy I know who's not turned the game off to my dad. I just want to say get well soon to my dad, who had major back surgery on Thursday and watching the game at Altman Hospital in Canton, Ohio. So hope he's doing well today.
Yeah, Ron, keep a smile on your face. Here's the handoff to the 47. And time now to take a look at the play of the game presented by Wrangler 5-Star Premium Denim with the call, Larry Munson.
And he now shift us into a new position, so we go into an eye. He goes underneath. He fakes to the tail. There's a man wide open. Touchdown in the end zone, right down the middle.
Well, he threw to a man, and I remember Larry getting a little more excited on that same play when they were at Tennessee, and it was David Greene to
909
for Ron Haynes. Yep. I'm just giving Larry a little air time.
Somewhere between then and the end of this game, he's going to remember that that was the old hobnail booter.
Lumpkin. Big run inside the 40. That's a 15-yard gallop, and Roman Harper makes the tackle.
It's a nice-looking young running back out of Lithonia, Georgia, Stevenson High School. Right now, Georgia working the clock a little bit as well. Good blocking inside. And you see the power of Lumpkin. Only one carry last week against LSU, and there you see 11 carries, 55 yards.
And the longest run of the day for Georgia. First down and 10. Here's Green. Has to reach. Gets it in the hands
at Lumpkin, the stiff arm, and he comes around the corner after putting that right arm on the helmet of Charlie Pepper.
See, running the football, he looks a lot like Musa Smith looked last year. I mean, he's big, he's physical. He looks like Musa running the football. Big, strong, stiff arm there. The only thing about him now is his development without the ball, you know? Blocking, protecting the passer, and those are the things that a young back, particularly a freshman back, is not nearly as good at, because in high school, he probably didn't have to block very much. I mean, he was running the ball most of the time.
Now Tyson Browning goes to the right, cuts back inside, and works his way to the 32-yard line. And the clock is nearing the 8-minute mark now as the Alabama kids look on. 37-23. It was 30-3 at one point. And this is another key third down play, third and four. A lot of players injured on both sides. The most prominent name would be Brody Croyle. Re-separated the shoulder. Spencer Pennington, his backup, injured right shoulder. Here's the handoff. Browning coming left. And let's see, I don't think he got enough. His knee may be ruled down short of up. There's the left foot spot. That's the desirable foot.
It's a nice cut by Tyson Browning, but Alabama was late getting set up defensively. They had guys that weren't in position. It was a quick snap by Georgia and a nice cut inside by Tyson Browning. But it was the quick count by David Greene, I think, that got him that first down, because Alabama was late getting set up.
On the ground, Georgia with 108. Alabama susceptible to the run the last 2 weeks. Last week, 198 yards by Cedric Cobbs of Arkansas. Here's Browning, they'll go right. Jeremy Thomas leading the way, and the tackle is made at the 22-yard line. Charlie Pepper.
Even though Georgia hasn't run for a lot of yards today, I mean, this is smart by Mark Richt, because they're working the clock as well. They're getting after Alabama. It's a tired defense. The last 2 weeks, they've given up a lot of rushing yards. Max Gene Gillis, the starting tackle, is down for Georgia. They already lost Daniel Inman earlier in the game. He's been replaced by Dennis Rowland. And now the other starting tackle, Max Gene Gillis, is down. If you take a look at Alabama's rushing defense, the last 2 weeks really have had trouble. And that's what Georgia's trying to do right now in the last 8 minutes or so of the ball game.
Son of Haitian immigrants from Miami, the sophomore, 6'4 and 348 pounds, getting some assistance. Looks like he's going to be okay. I would hope so.
It's funny, because talking to Neil Callaway, the line coach, yesterday, he said, you know, our inside guys, the two guards and the centers, have been kind of banged up with some shoulders and ankles. Our tackles have been healthy, and they've played really well. And today, both the tackles, the starting tackles, getting nicked up a little bit.
There's Neil Callaway, who is the offensive coordinator at Georgia and starred in the offensive line for the University of Alabama and Bear Bryant back in the 70s. Matter of fact, on the 1977 game program cover, he's one of those on the cover with Terry Jones, who's now an assistant strength coach at Alabama, and Pete Cavan, the father of Bama starting in David Cavan. Neil Callaway. Second and 7, 10th play of the drive. Lumpkin. Flags.
Well, that's costly for Georgia, because not only does it set him back 10 yards for the holding, but it also stops the clock, which helps Alabama.
Holding. Let's check the CBS Sports Line stat of the game. Ball control. Look at the time of possession for Georgia. And 79 plays. That underemphasizes, yeah. underlines what you were talking about.
Well, again, Alabama coming in the last 2 weeks, they'd averaged 64 plays a game. That's just not enough offensive plays to give yourself a chance to make good plays. They're going to probably, chances are, they're going to be even under that today with only 49 so far.
And last week, Arkansas ran 88 offensive plays
against Mike Shula's defense. Now David Greene after the penalty, it's second down and 17. 6:28 to go.
Let's look with press coverage.
And they back out. Green goes double coverage right side. Incomplete. Inside the five.
See, I think this is smart by Alabama to go press coverage because, number one, Fred Gibson isn't 100%. He's not blasting off the line of scrimmage. And these other guys, Michael Johnson, Damian Gary, they don't have the speed to run by you. Remember, Reggie Brown's out of the game. He's the other speed receiver. So they don't really have a guy right now that's going to get separation off of press coverage just by running a takeoff route. So I think it's a smart decision to get up in the face of these Georgia receivers and try to put pressure on David Greene.
Third and 17 with 6:12 to go in this one. Four-man rush again for Alabama. Here's Greene down the middle, caught by Gary. Short of the first down at the 19-yard line. That's a gain of 13. They needed 17. Let's see if they go with Billy Bennett. Yep. And Billy Bennett trots on. Young man in, who in his spare time has started a band. I'm up on these things.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah? Yep. Called Whole Lotta Angus. Haven't heard him play, but I heard about it. Flag down.
Yeah, illegal substitution. Trying to get a guy off the field. It was the freshman, Craig Lumpkin, who was out there and shouldn't have been out there for the field goal team.
Now Bennett trots off the field.
Well, Shackelford's coming in. They're trying to get the right lineman because they've had a couple tackles injured, and here comes Lumpkin late. He's the last guy off, so obviously, again, they broke the huddle with more than 11 guys, and well, those are the kind of things that drive a head coach crazy, particularly a meticulous one like Mark Richt. I mean, everything was excellent in the first half, but kind of sloppy in the second.
Here's the kick.
Oh, boy.
Oh, that's a whole lot of Angus.
That's a whole lot of angst.
The lead stays at 14.
Did this thing get blocked or did he just chunk it? I don't even think it got hit. I think he just chunked it.
92,000 plus on hand. Alabama against Georgia live from Sanford Stadium on the campus of the University of Georgia. Bulldogs jumped off to a 30-3 first half lead. We now stand at 37-23, and the injured player is Naughton McKay Lozier of Alabama. He is still down at the 25-yard line. Well, these two teams playing for the 65th time. The series goes back to 1895. In 1960, this was the first televised game ever by ABC, first college game. Joe Namath made his debut in 62. 64, Vince Dooley's Georgia coaching debut. In 65, it was called the controversial lateral play. In 85, Mike Shula led Alabama to a comeback victory. In 94, Jay Barker led the Bulldogs to a fourth quarter comeback. They won in 29-28 at Bryant Denny in Tuscaloosa. So a lot of really significant games over the course of the years between these two. Good news, Naughton McKay Lozier just walked off the field. First down and 10. Avalos, the redshirt freshman quarterback, hands it to Shawn Williams. Got some room. That's Thomas Davis. And he knocks him out of the
run inside behind the tackles. They've been pulling the guards and they've been getting outside on the counter trap. And that time, Justin Smiley did a nice job of getting out in front of the play and leading Shawn Williams. So bit by bit, even though there's only 5 minutes and 13 seconds left, they have gotten a little running room for Shawn Williams.
25 yards on the last play, first down and 10. Avalos, the third quarterback, draw play. Here's Hudson up the middle to the 43-yard line. Well, Eli Gold and Ken Stabler make up the radio announced team for the University of Alabama. Kenny, of course, all-time great at Alabama. He said he had a life-altering experience here in that 65 game. He was a starting safety, and he was the one who got caught on the lateral play.
And the next week after they lost, Bear Bryant called him in and said, son,
sides of the ball, it's probably added to the length of this game because it stretches maybe past 3.5 hours.
On second down, here's Hudson going left. Got a first down, and he's out of bounds inside the 35-yard line. All right, thank you, Tim. The 37-23 here. First and 10 at the 34-yard line. Hand off, Williams. Well, this is one of several SEC games today. Ole Miss knocked off Florida in Gainesville earlier today. Mississippi State finally ends the losing streak. They defeat Vanderbilt. And later tonight, a game of real significance, Tennessee, Auburn.
I think Auburn's going to get them tonight. I think they've won a couple games. They haven't played anybody really good when they've won those two games. But I just think tonight at home against the undefeated Volunteers, they're going to surprise them.
Second down and 10. Williams met at the line, knocked down. And the clock continues to unravel now. 3:35.
I'm gonna have to fast for a couple days before we go down there.
Yes, we will. Third and 9. Alabama's second, 2 of 11 on third down conversions. Quarterback draw. Avalos, Thomas Davis. Loose ball down. He was ruled down by contact.
Oh, what a play by Thomas Davis. Rushed the passer, read the draw, tackled the quarterback, knocked the ball out. It's coming from the top of the screen, and as soon as he read the draw, he chased it from the backside, and the ball comes out. Ruled that his knee was down before the ball came out, and it's a good call. Knee was down, and then the ball came out, and that was kind of a wasted play there on third down. Triandos Luke has kind of been the guy that's made some big catches on third down.
Blitz on fourth down. Deep, incomplete. And the ball goes over on downs.
Well, they brought pressure. Tim Jennings came off the edge. Odell Thurman came from the inside. And Jennings with the hit. Kind of lucky that that wasn't called a roughing the passer, because he kind of went in there shoulder first.
Now look at this. This looks like the Revolutionary War poster, the fife and drum. Pennington, Croyle, and there's Avalos. Almost joined him. Hand off to the fullback. Jeremy Thomas with a carry. Well, on your left is Spencer Pennington, his right shoulder. On your right is Brody Croyle, his left shoulder. And there is the redshirt freshman, Brendan Avalos. Timeout called, Alabama. 2 minutes and 10 seconds to go. 37-23. Two-10 remaining here at Sanford Stadium on the campus of the University of Georgia. David Greene and the Bulldogs hold a 14-point lead at 37-23, 2:10 to go. Second down and 6. And Georgia, if they win today, will be 4-1 for the year. They go to Tennessee next Saturday night.
Kind of a mixed bag for Mark Richt today. You know, a lot of good things, but some not so good things between bad execution in the second half, injuries.
Alabama uses its second timeout. One remaining, 2:05 left in the game.
Looking so long at these pictures of you.
Welcome to HP Digital Photography. HP Invented.
Here's the lineup tonight on CBS. We'll begin with 48 Hours Investigates, followed by Hack and The District. All new programming tonight on CBS. 2:05 to go, 37-23. As the Crimson Tide on the edge of going 2-4 for the year.
Yeah, but you know what? Even if that happens, Mike Shula has to be proud of this football team for what they've done and how they've come back in the second half against, you know, we didn't know they could have worse odds than what they came in here with, but they even had worse odds develop as the game went on. But they didn't quit.
And time towel for our selection is the player of the game in this 37-23 encounter. Thomas Davis, the safety for the Georgia Bulldogs. Five tackles today, two sacks and two hurries, and he also returned a block punt for a touchdown.
Well, the more he plays safety, the more comfortable he gets. And rushing the passer is just kind of like the icing on the cake for him. It's you know, the fun thing he gets to do. But he is so quick off the edge. And then he even gets to score a touchdown. So kind of just like in high school, playing a little bit of everything and even got a touchdown today.
Thomas Davis from Shelman, Georgia, over near the Alabama line. Well, we talked about this Georgia schedule. They're about to go 4-1. And they go to Tennessee next Saturday night, then at Vanderbilt, at home against the University of Alabama, Birmingham. We'll see them in Jacksonville against Florida. And then on the 15th, after a bye week, Auburn, Kentucky, and at Georgia Tech. And Mark Rick said yesterday, Todd, the one thing about, despite the loss at LSU, all of the goals they wish to attain are still available to them.
And that starts with winning the SEC East, and that's why they knew they couldn't afford to lose another SEC game this week. So they did what they needed to do.
Ely Kelso, there is a flag down. Shaud Williams makes the grab. There's a helmet loose, and Shaud Williams is out of bounds.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, you know, that's one of those extra bubbles on the top of Greg McClain's helmet. And the helmet stays on, but the bubble comes off.
There's got to be a helmet recall after that. Oh, boy. Uga was on the injured list for a while. Do you know that?
I didn't.
Rear left leg, tendon surgery back in the spring. Was probable for a while, but he's back out there now.
Good.
Well, Alabama's schedule now. They head back home against Southern Miss, then at Ole Miss. They will entertain Tennessee at the end of October at Mississippi State. LSU, illegal formation is the call. Then Auburn, and of course, they are still under sanctions by the NCAA. Ineligible for the SEC championship game, ineligible for a bowl. So when the sanctions were announced, two trips to Hawaii were quickly scheduled, and they'll take the second of those at the end of this year. Offsetting penalties, and we'll re-kick. And Gordon Ely Kelso back on the field. Ryan Jordan will snap it back. Let's see if Alabama's coming. They are. Ely Kelso. Fairly poor punt. .144 to go in this one. And Brandon Avalos on in place of Spencer Pennington, who was playing in place of Brody Coyle, is there. Here comes the blitz. Avalos hit as he lets it go. Incomplete.
Pennington or Brody Coyle. He's listed only at 6 foot, which means he's probably really only about 5'10" and a half, but harder to see over the line of scrimmage, and that time took a good shot in the midsection from Gerald Anderson.
Well, last year in Tuscaloosa, this Georgia team got a 32-yard field goal from Billy Bennett to win it 27-25. They're about to win this one. It will be the first time since 55-56 they've had back-to-back wins. This one tipped away at the 20-yard line.
as Avalos is under terrific pressure. Third and 10.
This ball almost got caught on the second tip by the secondary Alabama receiver, but take a look at the difference in yardage. And it's third and 10. I mean, this is two down territory for Avalos, so he doesn't have to get it all back on this play, third and 10, because they're going to go for it on fourth down. So if it's not open down the field, maybe dump it off underneath.
Here's the quarterback draw again. It will be fourth down. There's a scramble after a loose ball. A fumble. And Alabama appears to have retained it. Justin Smiley, number 78.
Remember, Alabama with no timeouts left in the ball game. Gerald Anderson, big guy hustling. He was in there on the pressure the play before, and that time stripped the ball out, chasing down the quarterback draw.
Fourth and 5 with a minute to go. Avalos, near side, incomplete. Tyrone Prothrow, the intended receiver, number 4. And nice. The ball goes over on down.
Yeah, nice play by Kenny Bailey. The ball kind of floated out there to Prothrow, and Kenny Bailey, number 15, got in there and stripped it out. Nice play.
So Alabama being out of timeouts, Georgia will take a knee.
Well, Mike Shula, in his first year, 2-4, will agonize over this game on the bus ride back home, and then he'll get home and see his wife and Samantha and his new baby daughter, Brooke Dorothy, and he'll say, you know what, life is good.
Remember what he told us on the phone on Wednesday? He got home at 11 o'clock. His team had lost in double overtime last Saturday to Arkansas, and Mike Shula said he got home at 11. He went in and hugged his newest daughter and then went down to make sure that Samantha was okay, kissed her, and he said, you guys, this is the greatest time of my life.
That's right.
On second down, David Greene takes a knee. Mark Richt and the Georgia Bulldogs go to 4-1 overall, 2-1. And Mike Shula and Mark Richt, two of the fine young coaches in college football, greet each other at midfield. Dogs won 37-23. Not that it was a thing of beauty.